With this lecture, we arrive at last at one of the two greatest of all Chinese painters, in my estimation. When people used to ask me, who is your favorite Chinese painter? I would say, for the early period, Xia Gui. For the later period, Shi Tao. We're going to have a lecture on Shi Tao, by the way, in a later follow-up series, so you'll see him too. For Xia Gui, we still need a really serious book-length monographic study. There isn't one. The study of him by Suzuki K, which was presented at a symposium in 1970, and which I refer to in this lecture, and I have it on your guide, didn't really take us very far. I myself wrote the biography of Xia Gui for the Encyclopedia Britannica, the 15th edition published in 1974, but that too is very short and doesn't take us far. I hope that the lecture that follows then, by presenting some of Xia Gui's finest works in good images, and adding what I hope is helpful commentary on them, will inspire some specialist in the future, maybe, to undertake the serious study event that we really need, because he is a very great master, as I hope you agree on watching what follows.
Active from the 1190s into sometime around 1240, Xia Gui held a position, Zhuo, in the academy, in that period, late 12th, early 13th century. Beyond that, very little is known about him. That's true of academy painters of the Southern Song generally, but it's particularly painful in the case of Xia Gui. We'd love to know more about him. The earliest book published on with information on artists published after his time in the late 13th century dismisses him scornfully as of no value. I'll quote that later. But in my view, he's the greatest of the Southern Song Academy masters. To some degree, he broke out of the academy mold, in certain of his paintings at least. And in other ways, he represents a grand culmination or perhaps transcendence of it. When people used to ask, who is your favorite Chinese painter? I would say Shi Tao for the late period, Xia Gui for the early period. And perhaps of the two even, Xia Gui is my favorite of all Chinese painters. And you'll see why I think as I talk, or at least I'll try to make a case for that. Okay, we'll put on the screen now two pictures, one of them a color slide which reveals the bad condition of the painting, and the other a black and white photograph in which you can see more of the composition and so on. A painting attributed to him only, but a good one to start with because it shows the connection with Li Tang. This small painting in the Palace Museum in Taipei, as I say, is seen in bad condition. For that reason, we couldn't bring it in the Possessing the Past exhibition. I wanted it badly, and I wrote about it even though it wasn't there. They wouldn't allow it because the condition is so bad. It needs remounting. Someone should remount it and touch in all these cracks and so forth. Now, the attribution is made in a piece of writing you can see in the upper right here, if you're sharp-eyed, by a late Ming calligrapher and connoisseur and collector or whatever named Wang Dao. Wang Dao here is, I think, absolutely right. It looks very much like an early work, I might say, of Xia Gui. Well, the connections with Li Tang are obvious. The whole shape of the upper landscape form, the mountain form, whatever, with the separate peaks sticking out a bit at the sides, and pine trees on the top, and so forth. The large X-cut sun texture strokes, which you see on the main mass and on the in the lower left and otherwise. There's more more things going on in the picture than you would find in a Li Tang picture. From the lower left, somebody is seen coming along the path. It's a snowy landscape, a wintry landscape, under a parasol or an umbrella. And then down below, a boat is moored, and I believe there's actually a figure or two down there too. At any rate, then in the lower center is a cluster of houses, the usual things we've seen along the path where somebody might stop and eat and rest and so forth, with trees. Then the path goes up behind the foreground ridge, you can't really see it, past the waterfall, to a place in the sort of middle left where there's a bridge, a covered bridge built over the waterfall, and then above that a temple. And there again, people presumably can stop and rest and so forth among the trees. And then the path goes on, as you see, very nicely done around the bluff. Texturing, the shaping of this massive rocky bluff is really very finely done. And the whole picture is quite masterly with its implicit narrative, its seasonal aspects, its quite powerful forms, and so on. Anyway, it makes good sense to attribute this to Xia Gui. This, by the way, exists in two other later imitations. I'll show those just to show you what's wrong. Here's one, which we'll put beside the good one, so you can see the difference. This is attributed to, it's Xiao Zhao, who is his Li Tong's pupil, and it's in the Palace Museum in Taipei. It has imperial seals and so forth. Well, not really Xiao Zhao, not really a Sung painting at all. But as you see, the whole upper form, the bluff here, has been sort of distorted so that these protruding pieces at the sides are enlarged and stick out like fingers or something, and where the whole bluff is much reduced in size. On the other hand, the temple and the bridge and all the human parts are enlarged and made more prominent. This artist can't hide them away in the way that Xia Gui does, or the artist of the other one anyway. And generally, it's just flattened, and the forms are outlined more heavily and squared off. Anyway, not a very poor imitation. And the next, please. This one was owned by C.C. Wong, as I remember, and it's attributed, well, crazily, to an early song artist named Gao Keming. But anyway, it doesn't matter. Again, the upper form is flattened out, and the two protruding peaks at the sides are enlarged, and all the human habitation and the buildings and the figures and all that are much more prominent and large, and it's all debased, certainly, by this change, made into a picture of much less interest and certainly a later date. Okay, going on. Now, if we don't have any dated Xia Gui, same as with Mo Yuan, we can't really, if we put together a kind of hypothetical development from early to later, we do it only on the basis of style. What seems to connect more clearly with earlier style, what seems to exhibit his style more fully, and so forth. This is a fan-shaped album leaf from the Palace Museum in Taipei. Men in a house or a waterside pavilion, open house, gazing at a waterfall. There's a signature here. I can't tell you exactly who it is, but I remember it is signed. And it may well be an early work of Xia Gui. It has less of his distinctive style, more of kind of everybody's, the whole academy style is a general style. Here the figures are turning uncharacteristically, looking back, looking to the right at the waterfall instead of looking out toward the waterfall. That's a little unusual. The boat that brought them is moored to their left here. A path leads in from the lower right, and then some quite lovely pine trees, and across the water, done in washes, the stream flowing out of the distance. And then up above, what is really most characteristic of Xia Gui is this top of the bluff. Xia Gui loves to paint these tops of ridges or with a bit of vegetation, with all the space, misty space below. So, okay, fine painting, very very likely Xia Gui in his early period, or so I would take it to be. Here is another fan painting. This one is or was in the collection of a very fine dealer in Kyoto, whom I knew very well, Yanagi. on Furumonzen in Kyoto. I hope he's still active. He has several children who also have stories there. Anyway, the whole family is active. Yanagi, I photographed this, saw it first, and photographed it in his collection, and published it actually first, I think, with his permission. This has a little signature, which you can see over at the left edge here, just saying Xia Gui, which seems perfectly okay to me. It's one of the returning scenes, which I make into a theme, and I'll show more of them later, just since they're very common in Southern Eastern Academy painting, especially. This theme of returning late, as I recommended last time, read the section on Southern Eastern Academy painting in my book, The Lyric Journey, where I deal with this in some considerable length and talk about why it was probably so popular in the Southern Eastern period. Okay, here, as you see in the detail, next please, here's the detail. A farmer, presumably, the standard figure, one of the standard figures, with his load over his shoulder on a pole, making his way across the bridge through this wintry landscape past the river and to a cluster of houses, a person seen inside one of them, and wintry trees, bare trees in this case, and snowy landscape, a little bit of texturing. Well, this seems a perfectly fine, genuine work of Xia Gui, and I would take it at least to be a reliable, genuine work. You can see the signature way over here on the left in the detail. All right, enough of that. Much more famous, maybe a little more dramatic, is this fan-shaped painting, which is in the Boston Museum of Fine Arts. This is the landscape with rainstorm, reproduced by Max Lohr and various others. This is quite commonly reproduced and accepted generally as his work. There is a kind of signature, maybe genuine, I suppose it is, written a little squidgily as if with a painting brush, but the same is true of the Fan Quan signature on the great Fan Quan painting. At any rate, somewhere here under the trees, I can't show you exactly, it was discovered, I remember when it was discovered, it was by the son of Zhuang Yan, named Zhuang Shun, as I remember. At any rate, probably okay, but in any case, it seems reliable as one of the works of Xia Gui. This is in a slightly looser style, and in this case, we have the calligraphy fan that accompanied it. I don't have a slide of it, but anyway, with the imperial calligraphy. And it reads, quote, "All through my life, a weary sleep is joined to river rain, for whole days traveling by boat, as wind tears the banks," end quote. So the persona of the person who is writing or composing the poem, so to speak, is located not in the among the leafy and wind-blown trees on the shore or the house, but out in the boat, imagining going past this, in other words. The same poem or couplet translated by Wu Tong, who was the curator at Boston, goes, "The ceaseless river rain always lulls me to sleep. Winds beat the cliffs all day to move my boat along," end quote. So, whichever you take. At any rate, a fine painting. Here is the detail. Here we go, yes, the detail. You can see the rather looser brushwork, which maybe is more characteristic of later Xia Gui. One would guess that anyway. A house seen through the trees, which are windblown, quite beautifully rendered and freely rendered. This slide also shows you the damage. If it were my painting, I would have taken it off long ago to my favorite mounter in Tokyo, Meguro, who would have touched in all these holes and made it a really quite handsome work. I don't know why the Boston Museum doesn't do that. They should, anyway. But even this way, it's a fine painting and probably a reliable work of Xia Gui. Now then, let's see, going on. Now we come here in a pretty good color, a picture taken from a color reproduction. It's a painting in ink on silk. This is one of the one of my favorite paintings and one of Max Lohr's favorite paintings. And I sort of inherited the passion for it from him. This is the cottage beneath trees. Again, someone arriving late because the darkening of the sky indicates it's late in the day. Someone in the lower right here arriving with a load over his shoulder on a pole, about to walk over the bridge and make his way around the trees of this riverside little hump of earth. And the house is seen under the trees. And then in the left you have indications of the river, the water. And then moving up to the right, a few more buildings and more trees on the slope. Well, here I have a black and white picture, which maybe makes it clearer, the composition and so on. This is a painting. It has a signature. It's sort of in the middle bottom here, but it doesn't look like it says Xia Gui. At any rate, it seems not easy to read, and I leave it simply as a mystery, whether it was written in by somebody, it's a rather odd place, or just what. I would like to take it as a Xia Gui painting in any case, even though the signature doesn't help. And here a detail of the lower of the house under the trees while I talk. Well, this is, if you have followed my lectures and developed your eye, as I hope you do, your eye for painting of this kind, or for Chinese landscape painting generally, I hope you'll realize that in its unshowy way, this is a near perfect little painting. The trees are fused into groves, but differentiated by varieties of different brushwork. There's no prominent brush strokes anywhere in the painting. The execution is somehow fused into the image in a quite remarkable way. This intensifies the whole effect of stillness in the scene. There's no longer spots of interest located here and there around the scene. The whole effect is of concentration, or distillation, you might say. No obtrusive technique of any kind, no style to speak of. It's an unassuming picture everywhere. There's very little trace even to the painter's hand. It's as if some mysterious identification with the subject had produced it, nature before us, so to speak, not the work of man. I say that, of course, almost in the words of Max Luhrer, who talked about it that way. He sees it as a landscape with rain and fog in his book, and he writes this, quote, "There is no technical elegance, no display of skill. Instead, we are faced with something more profound, as if it were nature itself." Well, that's very good, Max Luhrer. Now, here's a slide of the slope. I saw this finally in the Tokyo National Museum, and I remember very well. It's in an album called Hikkoen, Japanese for, Bigungyuan, meaning the garden plowed by the brush, a poetic title for an album brought together in Japan with, I forget, what is it? Is it 30 or 40 anyway, a fairly large number of leaves. Some others that are notable, some quite a lot that are not particularly notable. And this is among them. I waited for years and years while this was in a private collection, inaccessible. Nobody seemed to know where it was even. And then it was acquired by the Tokyo National Museum. And at last I was able to see it and make a few slides. My slide of the whole didn't turn out so well, but these details are pretty good. So here you see this completely unassuming hand. You scarcely can talk of the hand of the artist at all. The slope, the more distant trees, the roofs of a few buildings seen over the slope. Well. Okay, enough of that. I think I've made the point as well as I can, my point on Max Luhrer's. People sometimes ask why, when Max Luhrer made so many mistakes, got it so wrong as far as attribution and dating, why do you go on praising him so? Well, it's because he said the right thing so many times about the paintings, and he communicated so much of that, how to look at paintings, to his students, even when he got it badly wrong on dating. Well, it was hard to do otherwise, because when he went through his training and formed his ideas and so on, we didn't have access to it as much as we did in my time. All right, enough of that. Now, there are several related paintings in Japanese collections mainly. Not as good as that one, or not as not as unobtrusive or simple as that one, but quite fine in their own way. This is one of them. Now let's see where. This is in the Seikado in Tokyo, I think. I believe that a private museum. Very, very Japanese mounting, by the way. You couldn't miss it. And it has more or less the same subject. The figure coming across the bridge in the lower right. A little more obtrusive landscape forms in this case. The path in this case goes around the slope to the left. And the building is seen here, is it? Yes. But put her behind the trees. Well, yeah, down here, very unobtrusive lower. And then sailboats or boats seen at the left, moored on the shore. Here a black and white sled, but they may show more in just a minute now. And here's a detail, okay. Yes. Here, as I say, the hand of the artist is a bit more obtrusive, but still possible, I think, for Xia Gui. The, rather simple texturing, light and shadow effects that shape the forms, and tree foliage, particularly treated in this loose, very convincing way. And this is just the roof of the building. On the other hand, here's a version of it. Next, please. This was formerly in the Iwasaki collection, I think. Iwasaki in Japan. It was published in books like The Pageant of Chinese Painting and was well known, and it was published as a Xia Gui. And I think it came to the States, and the last I heard it was somewhere in Minneapolis, I think, collection. But I don't know where it is now. But at any rate, it's a copy, I'm pretty sure. The whole composition, as we saw it in the Seikado version, is somewhat loosened and spread out here. The hand of the artist, whoever it is much more prominent, much more obtrusive, you might say. Well, that, I hate to use that word, but to be negative about it, yes. You can see the brush strokes, and the brush strokes have more of a calligraphic character. Look at the shoreline here in the lower left, the little strokes that start and end rather clearly in this calligraphic way. Here's a detail from it, indeed. Yes, here we go. Now you can see that. Well, this is the hand of a copyist. The copyist knows enough about Xia Gui to use a kind of split brush technique in painting the trees. He did that sometimes, but not so prominently as this. And here you can see very well in the lower left, these rather calligraphic brush strokes that don't belong really in the Xia Gui style. Enough of that. Now, let's see, there was another one, by the way, which I tried to bring to the U.S., and it would have gone to our museum in San Francisco if I had been successful, but failed. All right, that's another story. It ended up being registered and kept, I think, in the Kyoto National Museum, quite fine, too. Formerly owned by a dealer. Now, Sakamoto. No, anyway, never mind. Okay, here we go. Next one. This is an album leaf, square album leaf, in the Boston Museum of Fine Arts, Boating on an Autumn River, it's called there. I have it in my Lyric Journey book, and a color reproduction, and the book by Wu Tong, Tales from the Land of Dragons, 1800 Years of Chinese Painting, published by the Boston Museum of Fine Arts. Well, it's a lovely leaf. I have two color details. Let's put the first of those on beside it, yes. I would like to say Xia Gui. It has no attribution, but it's not very obviously Xia Gui style, and yet the sheer quality and conception of it, and that ridge painted up at the upper right with vegetation on it, that's very much Xia Gui style. And I'd like to think that somewhere along in his development, Xia Gui might have done this picture. At any rate, it's quite a lovely leaf of a man, our typical gaucher, lofty scholar, or whatever, and his boatmen arriving in the boat on the right, and they are about to, here you see them in the detail, about to land, and the path which he will take leads into the misty trees. It's autumn, red leaves, mist of fog in the trees, And so when one is absorbed, one's vision, so to speak, is pulled back into the fog, quite mysterious and wonderful experience. And then here's a detail of the upper right, and then the path continues on a further on the shore, in a dimmer passage. Here are the red leaves drawn quite sharp in the foreground for the nearer trees, and then the further trees seen only very dimly in the mist, quite wonderful. And then above that, fog, and this crest, which reminds me very much of Xia Gui. Well, Xia Gui or not, I wanted to present the picture and give my reasons for thinking, or at least wishing, that it really is a Xia Gui painting. Okay, now, the grand masterpiece, I quickly say, this isn't it, this is a copy. Put this on the screen, please. The grand masterpiece among the surviving Xia Gui paintings, and perhaps the grand masterpiece of the whole school surviving, is a long handscroll painted in ink on paper, titled A Pure and Remote View Over Rivers and Mountains, Qishan Qingyuan Tu. And this is the title from which I took my name for this whole series, A Pure and Remote View, because it's a favorite painting of mine. It's reproduced well in the Possessing the Past catalog. That's a complete reproduction, so it's very good. Sections of it in Mascara Book and 3000 and Chinese Art Treasures and Seren and so forth. This is another copy attributed to Xia Gui in the old collection of the Metropolitan Museum of Art, registry number 13.220.18. Now, in my catalog essay for the Possessing the Past catalog, I reproduced also a couple sections, I remember, three sections, whatever, of a copy in the Metropolitan Museum of Art. I think it may be actually attributed to Maran, but it seems to be a copy of the same scroll. There are several copies in existence. It seems to have been a popular composition. And the beginning of the copy shows what may have been the beginning of the original scroll, which now is not complete. That is, the genuine Xia Gui painting does not contain the entire composition. We know that from different copies anyway. Now, where it seems to have begun, as you see here, with a broad view over a river flowing out of the distance into the foreground, and fishermen along the shore, and on the left side here, thatched houses among trees, a village, a cluster of houses, and people coming out. Now, what I believe is that the whole scroll is a kind of extended version of what I speak of as the lyric journey, in which our ideal figures, the gaucher or lofty scholars anyway, whom you see in all these paintings, people living in retirement after being bureaucrats or whatever, cultivated people who enjoy nature in a very sophisticated way. Anyway, the gaucher are seen coming out of thatched houses. And this is the beginning of what I speak of as the lyric journey. They set off on some kind of trip or walk through nature to enjoy the scenery. And then as we go on, we see more figures and things they enjoy. Here's the next section. The next section of temple in the distance. And this is, of course, the hand of a copyist. It's very hard. It's later. But it preserves no, and it includes several things that are not in the original, in the corresponding section, more buildings and more figures. And then, on the left here, a path going around the mountain and so on. And then in the third section seen here, we come to, at the left, the section with people arriving at a temple, which we'll see a temple in the trees with big roofs, which we see, this is the main section in the main painting. By this time, we're corresponding to the main painting. And then if we were to go one further, we would see here the passage where the whole thing disappears or goes off into the misty distance and the river and the villages along the way and the city. Well, this corresponds so nicely to the real painting that we can, I think, take the earlier part to be an indication of how it began. So here is the beginning of the present scroll now. We miss all the sections of the beginning, which I would take to be the section in which our ideal figures, the people who populate the scroll along with fishermen and farmers and so forth, lower class figures, on which they set off from their place where they were living, along with the common people out in nature. Okay, here at any rate is the first part of the whole scroll. There are several places in the scroll which are transitional, you might say, nothing happening in them, but quite beautiful passages of foreground rocks and slopes, and slopes with crests, these lovely crests that Xia Gui loves so much, foreground trees, middle ground trees, more simply drawn, and then distant mountains, but space, mass and space, wonderfully represented mass and space. The rocks, as you see, have some remnants of the old Li Tong manner of axe-cut texture stroke, but very broad now. And the old Li Tong manner of rendering the sides of them, some darkened, some lit by light. All this is so easily done now that you're scarcely aware of it. A quite dramatic pine tree here at left against the mist. In the next section, we have a huge boulder in the foreground and more mist beyond, and then the beginnings of the section which you have shown from the first lecture on, I think several times, so you're familiar with it by now. The section in which, one of these sort of climactic bits of the painting in which you see people arriving at a temple. Okay, here's the transitional bit, and then next, please, here's the section which you know very well from, I had it on for a long time in the first lecture. And this is what I reproduced, I think, not yearbook, but in other places reproduce it. Here's the Chenlong Emperor's inscription up in the upper sky, but we sort of ignore that. He should be ignored generally. Bad poetry, badly written. Anyway, bad verse, not even poetry. And here, anyway, the upper right is one of those lovely crests that Xia Gui paints so well, with dimly shaped, in contrast to the further ridges and mountains, which are simply in silhouette, and trees growing out from it. But in the foreground, we see one of the focal points in the painting, where we're sort of invited, so to speak, to stop and gaze for a while. First of all, there are two pilgrims with broad hats and carrying, one of them carrying a load, Buddhist pilgrims, it looks like, making their way into the picture and across the bridge. And then across the bridge and in the space in front of the temple are two of these Gaoshir lofty scholars and their servant, and rock seats. Here's a detail of that section which shows it more. Yes. One of them is turning to the servant, the other stands holding his staff, and they are about to enter the temple. They've come there to enjoy the scenery, to visit the temple, perhaps to have some spiritual event in the temple, and maybe stay there for a while, rest, and then go on. The temple building is drawn among the trees. This is quite wonderful. Nobody else is able to integrate architecture and trees with this ease, and the ease also with which he draws the tree groups. Foliage not carefully distinguished, but distinguished enough so you can distinguish the individual trees one from another, according to the kind of foliage or leafage, and the nearer ones on the right and the slightly further ones on to the middle left, distinguished in their ink tonality. And then up above, next please, here's the roofs of the temple and the crest up above seen in detail. All of this handled with such ease, with no clear sign of the artist's hand or no showy brushwork or any of that stuff. He's way beyond that. He is able to shape this bluff up here in the upper right so easily that you just read it in its shape, and you read the trees growing on it without being at all conscious of the painter's hand. Okay, now here we go on. Then a transitional bit here, here's a detail of it, in which we see another old scholar down here arriving with his staff bent over, showing his age, and his servant coming along behind, carrying the usual wine gourd, whatever it is, something, something to eat maybe, over his pole. And then the huge boulder that sort of pushes us off into the next section, which is, as you remember, a recession along the riverbank. And here it is. This is just beyond what we've just seen. Boats moored, the old guy that we just saw making his way toward the temple has come from one of these boats. And then the shoreline goes back, and we've seen these already, but I'll show them again. Here is the fishing village with thatched roofs, buildings, two people meeting in the foreground, dimly seen, buildings on the shore, and a fishing the device for raising the net in the lower left here. This, of course, goes all the way back to the Xia Gui painting. We've seen numbers of these done carefully or understandably as here, or done sloppily as we saw in a painting by Wang Shun, an aristocrat artist. Anyway, okay, I won't go that again. But throughout here, when you blow this up, it's a little like the painting we saw before, probably by Li Sung of the West Lake, in which the artist is able to blur and lighten parts of the painting to somehow reproduce the experience of seeing something through mist and at a distance quite beautifully. And then as you go back still further along the shore, you come to more houses, more trees, willow trees, and so on. And then in the far distance, a walled city with a gate and with a great roof over it and roofs of houses inside, a city by the river in this ravine. And above it, again, a quite wonderful bluff with foliage. Here, now let's see. Yes, here's the next section, which you see this city. It's in some ways, I say, like the Li Sung West Lake picture, because the Academy artists were able to relax their hands without losing anything of their, as I said, representational skills, and able to map out, plot out, lay out the entire scene just faultlessly, just as you could, as if you're gazing at it and seeing things at different distances and looking different ways. And okay, next. Then beyond that, okay, that fades away. And for a while, as you roll the scroll, you're rolling blank paper, except for the beastly emperor, which is a great big seal right in the wrong place. Okay, forget that if you can. Anyway, and just washes of ink, for atmosphere, and then two boats and then a third boat appear coming toward us. It's typical of handscrolls that for dramatic effect we have boats and other travelers and so forth generally coming toward us as we roll. And then you see down below here the beginning of another section, just a little low shoreline, a bit of bamboo, a viewing pavilion, Tingza, whatever, on the shore, and then the next section, and it is, here it is, a great cliff, a dramatic, vertical, massive form that comes in like a crash of timpani and brass in a symphony, breaking this slow, this quiet passage. And here you see the viewing Tingza down here in the middle lower part, among the bamboo, and this cliff done something like, I suppose you might say, the cliff in the painting we started with, the attribution by Wang Dao, the winter landscape. A massive form with enough texturing in the crucial places to bring out its rockiness, enough shading, dark to light, to bring out the shape of the form, vegetation on the top, and rocks, eroded rocks down below, as indeed is true in nature. Notice, by the way, there's still something of the old Li Tong kind of contour line drawing, if you see the contour of the cliff. There are innumerable copies of this, all the way to Sesshu in Japan, all with this great cliff coming in after a passage of a stretch of water. Far in the far lower left here, you see two figures making their way, two of the our Gaucher figures out enjoying nature, making their way toward the viewing pavilion, the Tingzi, where they will sit and gaze at the scenery. Okay, let's go on now. Here is a detail of the cliff showing just how effectively it is shaped and how the bottom of it is hollowed, as it might be by the erosion of water. And now we begin to see bits of or drawing of water swirling around it. Throughout the whole middle passage, there wasn't much, if any, paintment or indication of water, because we were gazing at it from a distance. And here you can see closer up the brushwork, which works very effectively, but is not brushwork for its own sake. There's nothing expressive about this, or not, for God's sake, looking at the artist's personality. Yuck. Sorry, I'm being partisan here. Now here's the same scene, seen a little bit further along. And here we can see better the two scholars arriving with their servant carrying a chin for one of them, which one of them will play as they sit in this tingza. And then, if you know, there's several more things going on than you think at first. Up in the top, upper right, through the foliage, and I'll have a detail in a minute, you can see the roofs of a temple again. So there's a Buddhist temple up there, accessible in some way, probably, okay. And then you can see a path with a railing leading upward in the sort of middle, slightly left of middle. And then, as I'll show in a detail in just a bit, there's a cave with two people seated in it. Two more people have come out to enjoy nature, and they have climbed to this cave. And they're sitting there simply talking and talking quietly and enjoying their scenery. Well, the combination of this enormously powerful composition, the masses, these rocky masses, and the spaces, and the atmosphere, and everything, is just, I think, overwhelming. It's never been done as well again. Next, please. For just copies, endless copies of this. Here's the upper part with the temple seen through the seen among the leafy trees. The next, please. Yeah, and here's the passage with the figures, the two of them. You see them in this little bit upper right in a cave, seated on rocks, one of them something under his arm. These figures like these, facing each other. We saw them in a Mayan painting in Boston. We'll see them, we could see them eventually in Sesshu painting. Sesshu loved them. This pair of figures is endlessly repeated in imitations and so on. And here you can see up close the wonderful texturing of the rock and the railing of the pathway, of the path leading along the cliff down below. Well, how to put it? This texture, in the old sense as it was done by Li Tong and before him by Swan Quan and so on, is radically reduced, not disappearing, but reduced. But is a brilliant use of tonal values for all the effects of distance and space and so on. The rocks are not so elegant as Ma Yuan's. The trees are more loose and free. And much of the painting is dramatic, but much of the rest of it is quiet, truly remote, profound. My lyric journey theme, I think, is exemplified here. At least I argue that way. And I describe it as we go. That is, people start out at the beginning, now lost, in their village, wherever they are living. And then they make their way, well, they stop at the temple and visit there. They move in boats. They stop at a little viewing pavilion under the great cliff, etc. Let's go on then a little bit. Yes, here's the next section now. Now we have another transition section that's simply made up of massive rocky forms and little indications of how you get from one place to another, bits of the path and so on. A quite wonderful slope or almost flat area in the left foreground, indicated only by washes. And then rocky masses, progressively lighter as you go back, shaped wonderfully with different faces of the trees, and then a ravine with fog, and then needle peaks in the upper left. This is the sort we have in Li Tong paintings. Well, the whole thing embodies, I think, an extreme clarity of thought and vision. And again, I echo Max Luhr in saying that. Okay, The trees, as you see here on the left, are fused into groups, but differentiated within the group by varying kinds of brushwork. There's some sense of movement in the execution, but stillness in the whole scene generally. The whole thing is polished, terse. Those are Max Luhr's words, I think. The culmination of a whole movement. Well, it's hard to think where it will go from here. What's going to happen next? Well, we'll talk about that. It's as though he has rid the landscape of all heaviness, dissolved substance, penetrated with mist. One has glimpses through the mist of things to see, sometimes close up and obvious, sometimes mistily here. I mean, it's in the distance. Okay, the next section, I may not have absolutely all the sections here, but pretty much all. Then we have a scene with a covered bridge, and then to the left of it here, thatched houses and figures. So we're back to a little bit of human habitation. And on the bridge, there were two figures, I remember. I'll have a detail of it in a minute. Anyway, some dramatically crossed pine trees on the right side and leafy groups of leafy trees beyond that, and these powerful landscape forms, and then beyond, nothing except washes of ink, as though we were gazing out. Well, I should say here that as you go on in the scroll, the washes of ink in the upper part become a bit heavier, not strikingly, but heavier, as though the day is growing later. And I believe that's indeed what is happening. And you end with a scene of return, as we'll see. So it does follow my ideal narrative. This scene, showing the slope at the right and the leafy trees and these dramatic pine trees, and then the bridge with two figures, I think it's one person gazing at the scenery and his servant behind him, bridge built up on posts, covered bridge, and then on the to the left here, thatched houses with figures. Okay, the next, please. Let's see. Yes. Okay. Here's the detail of the right side with the dramatic pine trees, spiky, long. I mean, they end with sharp strokes, giving this sort of dramatic effect of pushing outward, and bits of leafage or pine needles. Seen. They're very clear what they are. And here you can see the drawing of the bridge. And then here on the other side, here's the bit with the thatched houses on the shore and people in a boat unloading some kind of goods that they brought by boat. Somebody handing something heavy to somebody on the shore. And something, in other words, sort of semi-commercial going on. And then beyond that, the houses, where we are to understand whatever it is going to be used. Maybe it's an inn. I don't think there's a flag, but at any rate, okay. Now, here, let me show this. I should say that this scroll, as I say, exists in many copies, but two of the old copies of sections of it are in Japan, in Japanese collections. And they're very long in Japan, and they're very famous. And one scholar I'll speak of later, Suzuki K, actually argued that these are closer to the original, and that the painting in Taiwan was the later copy, a Ming copy or something. I think he's quite wrong. And I spoke up after his paper, which was given in a symposium, the first great international symposium in Taiwan in 1970. I spoke up after his paper, pointing out something that originally had been pointed out by Robert Treat Payne, a curator of Japanese art for many years at the Boston Museum of Fine Arts. Payne, who was writing an article about a Japanese painter who copied this composition, had made a point about the difference between the Japanese version and the Chinese. Over here on the left in the Japanese version, as I take it to be, there are two buildings, both with flags out, as though they are both inns, both about the same size. And as Payne said, this indicates a kind of competition, a theme that wouldn't have been allowed in a Chinese painting, which was much too sort of idealized to inject the idea of two places competing with each other for customers. It's funny, but I think true point. I think Payne is absolutely right. But in general, these are much sharper brushwork and heavier forms, and Everything about them is, I think, wrong for Xia Gui. So I'm on the opposite side from Suzuki K. And I said so at the time. I'll speak about that paper again. Here's a detail of the Japanese copy, which is in one of the great museums in Japan. I forget which. Doesn't matter. And you see people in the houses. It's all a lot more going on in the painting. And you see the rather more prominent brushwork, heavier brush line. Well, this is the hand of a Japanese copyist, I believe. Okay, now going on with the real scroll. So slide of the next section. This is a detail from it, and we have another passage of human habitation, a little cluster of thatched houses of the kind where you might stop and rest, and you indeed see somebody sitting at a table inside the building and a servant coming and serving him something, a bowl of soup or whatever. And outside, a servant with a mule and a load of things. Anyway, quite beautiful painting of the trees, again, the nearer and further separated by ink tonality, quite wonderfully handled. Okay, enough of that. Next, please. Then comes a passage which is one of the great ones. Here the mountain peaks loom above an area of mist. And the mist, actually, the misty gorge that somehow goes below the lower limit of the handscroll, as though way, way down below. Well, how can you represent space below the limit of the handscroll? You can't, except he does. How he does it, you arrive at a little tinsel here, a viewing pavilion, located here in the more or less middle right, on the rocky ledge overlooking this misty depth, and then with wonderful subtle use of ink washes, he suggests the mist and the trees to the left here growing from down below, indicating more depths below. So he gives the effect of a bottomless, more or very deep gorge of some kind, filled with fog, powerful. And then rising above this, these extraordinarily powerful mountain forms. As I say, this is the whole thing is the culmination of a whole movement we've been seeing from through Li Tong and eventually Ma Yuan and so on, and perhaps culminating here. But it's hard to think of where it might go from here. He has somehow rid the landscape of all the kind of heaviness that it has in some others, Li Tong and so on. Mist penetrates the scenes here and the valleys and gorges and so forth. By comparison, Ma Yuan's paintings seem, not only dramatized, but somewhat artificial. Too much of the artist's hand and temperament, so to speak. Nothing in this, there's nothing of that kind of hand of the artist in the real Xia Gui as I see it. Ma Yuan's is an imitable style, and indeed you have just endless imitations of Ma Yuan. But Xia Gui scarcely is, and there's scarcely any followers of Xia Gui, in China certainly. His style does underlay a certain amount of great painting in the Muromachi period in Japan. That's another matter. I'll speak of very briefly at the end. But it's hardly followed up in China. Something as great as this, condemned by this awful critic at the end of the 13th century and others as something just too low class to be worth looking at. Well, okay. Landscape painting, just to speak about that a bit more. Landscape painting has been developing in certain directions toward a more subtle use of ink monochrome for atmosphere and space, toward a softening of forms, toward eroding them with mist, so to speak. More and more spacious paintings, less of solid mass. And by the time of Xia Gui, we have what seems to be a total mastery of this. Now, where can landscape go from here? We'll see where in Shan or Zen painting in our last lecture, a further dissolution into paintings that might seem to be even more a dead end. Well, that's a kind of false art historical construction involving deterministic notions about art that we have to avoid. So I take it back in a way. There are no dead ends really in painting or elsewhere. But okay, next please. Here is the detail of the little tingzi on the edge of the gorge, or the great foggy bottom, whatever, space, where one imagines sit-in looking down into it. All right, then the next one, next please. Here is the section that I reproduced a part of, at least, in my Skira book long ago. And we're getting later. The sky is a bit darker, and darker washes are appearing up in the upper part of the picture. And we have another huge rocky mass which sort of pushes us leftward, impelling us as if on our way toward the end of the painting. A group of leafy trees. And then down here, a bridge built of poles, only one rail on one side, very simply built. Here's the detail of it. Here's the detail. With a returning farmer, or whoever it is, making his way over this bridge, a familiar figure by now, and making his way toward the end of the scroll where it will end. In the distance, vegetation seen through the fog, drawing of the swirling water coming out of the middle ground and flowing into the foreground. Just the sheer achievement of drawing the water so that it establishes the ground plane as fully as this, as easily as this, and so as convincing as this. Well, as I said, all this is rejected, that along with Southern Swing Academy painting generally, and belittled by the dominant literati critics of the beginning of the Yuan Dynasty, who begin publishing at that time and or writing stuff that's still preserved. As an example, you can see in the Bush and Schur book, pages 138 to 40, excerpts from the writing of the critic Zhuang Su, writing around 1298, very end of the 13th century, who calls Xia Gui's paintings exceedingly vulgar and bad, and suggests that they were popular only because they belonged to an age of great corruption and so on, not really worth our attention. On the other hand, Xia Gui's greatness was recognized by some later critics, and one should say that for the later critics. Dong Qichang, the late Ming great painter critic, wrote favorably about Xia Gui in contrast to the others. According to him, he says he followed Li Tong, but he painted in a more terse and abbreviated manner. That's true enough. And then he goes on, in making things fade away or disappear in his landscapes, he had the two me's at the tip of his brush. So what he's saying there is that he had somehow absorbed the work of Mi Fu and his son Mi Yuran. Well, it may be that something of their achievement underlies what Xia Gui does. That's not impossible art historically. On the other hand, boy, in my somewhat biased view, the two me's, neither of them could touch anything like this. They weren't painters of that stature. Dong Qichang goes on saying this: most painters round off the square to make a curve, but he put corners on the round to make a square of it. Well, you can judge for yourself what he means by that. It's something about the way he paints rocks and so on. Quite good. Then here we come to the end of the... just a minute. Here's the end of the scroll. Now, we don't have a good... the department slide of this part was missing, so we had to make one from an old reproduction of the thing in the center. Not very good. But that slope that comes after the bridge, you can see the end of the bridge over here at the right. With our returning farmer, or our returning rustic anyway, the slope comes up rather not dramatically, quietly, and then just beyond it, we see what is now the end of the scroll. Maybe it was a bit longer originally, but it's a proper ending. An inn or a hostel by the river, dramatic pine tree, a gate. Here is a detail, very of the ending of the present scroll. A gate in the wall, an earth wall, and a man with a donkey inside, parasols of some kind here. And then among the trees and facing outward, rooms in the inn that are built so that you can dine or drink wine or whatever while gazing out over the water. Quite wonderful. Quiet ending in exactly the place where our farmer wants to reach to rest, and finally having reached his destination. I should say, by the way, that Suzuki K's paper in the 1970 Taipei International Symposium, which I spoke about, titled Xia Gui and the Pictorial Style of the Southern Sung Court Academy, is just about the only serious attempt to deal with Xia Gui as a whole that we've had, unfortunately. One of my students, and I won't name her because she never finished, but she's a marvelous student, but she never quite finished, never did it, took on Xia Gui. Suzuki K, anyway, didn't recognize any originals at all, and he thought that this pure and remote view handscroll was a later, maybe Yuan period or Ming period, court tracing copy, and he thought the two Japanese pictures were earlier in the original, if not original, at least earlier. But anyway, we didn't recognize any originals at all, so it's as if there were no real Xia Gui. Max Lohr, who was there in the discussion afterwards, quoted Voltaire saying, "If God didn't exist, we would have to invent him." Very nice, I think. He was saying the same thing about Xia Gui. In other words, if Xia Gui is such a great artist, if there are no genuine Xia Gui paintings, we'll have to invent some. Well, it's hard to say what he meant. It was more figurative than otherwise. Okay, then, here we go. Now going on, after having finished that great scroll, I made you look at it for a long time, was exactly what I meant to do. Now I bring back here, briefly, the two paintings that we looked at earlier at the end of our discussion of Li Tang, the two paintings in the Koto Inn in Kyoto, a temple, which has a rubbed out signature of Li Tang hanging here from this uppermost branch of the tree in this one of the two. And I mentioned then that these are clearly 13th century works after Xia Gui, and that they would be obviously that once we had seen what the contribution of Xia Gui was. So I bring them back now just to make this obvious point. Now you see this great mass in the foreground, and here's a detail of it, rocky mass. This is a kind of further relaxation of the Xia Gui manner of large axe cut tsun, or what remains of it, large brush strokes swept across parts of the mass, and bright, highly lit and highly darkened surfaces, dramatic shaping of the forms. That comes from Xia Gui. The trees, here is a detail of the trees again, something of the twisting trees and the way the foliage is done. This comes from Xia Gui. I don't think this is a court painting. I think it was done by some artist working outside the court who picked up the style, as indeed they did, and does it in a rather looser, even more dramatic or overly dramatized form. It couldn't have been as loose and free as this if it were a court painter. I put it in my old index of Chinese painters, and I said by some 13th century master, post Xia Gui and outside the academy, and my colleague Dick Barnhart, who'd argued against this for a long time, sort of scoffed at this and said it was just an overly precise attempt. But I think it's the truth of it. Here is the picture again of the man in the distance with his gourd, or big gourd thing, whatever, carrying over his shoulder, wine gourd, and the dian, the dots. This is all the hand, as I say, of some late Sung artist. Here's the tree foliage, and you'll see echoes of Xia Gui, or imitations of Xia Gui, in the handling of the tree leafage and so forth. Okay, here's the other one with the quite dramatic, quite fine paintings in their own way, with the waterfall and the two figures. Well, I looked at it at some length when they were doing Li Tang, so I won't talk about it at great length again. The two figures, like figures maybe in Xia Gui or Wei Chen, and the bear tree, rather looser than Xia Gui would have done it, and with more of the calligraphic brushworky in it, and broad strokes to handle them for the masses. And here's the trees again, twisting, and as I said before, the twigs and leaves and so on, rather detached and not so clearly attached to the tree branches as it would have been in Xia Gui. Looser on the whole, and more dramatic and quite fine in its way, but we'll probably be a bit later. The next, please. Now here, this is, here I'll put it in two versions. The one on the left is from a photograph, the one on the right is from the original, but after it has been remounted. So let's have those two side by side while I talk. Now this is a painting in the Freer Gallery, in the old collection. That's the things collected by Freer himself. It had been published by Bachhofer, and I think Lehrer may have published it somewhere. Both of them admired it very much. Now, according to records, this painting may have had a Xia Gui signature somewhere in the upper left, up among the trees or somewhere in there, but it was lost in remounting. Unhappily, this painting went through a rather bad time. An older Freer Gallery painting mounter named Kinoshita, who kept on working in his old age when he should have retired and been replaced, did this painting, remounted it in his old age, and rather badly. Instead of using lighter silk or whatever paper to back it, and then retouching through the holes, he used a darker paper, as I remember, and so that he didn't have to retouch. He was quite old. But that darkened the whole picture and made it, it was something that shouldn't have happened. Now, I had our good mounter, Sugiura, remount the painting. Well, Sugiura had all kinds of trouble taking the backing off because Kinoshita had also used a paste that was too hard. And I remember going all over Washington, D.C., trying to find a kind of digestive powder, actually it was, that would soften the paste. In other words, it would soften the flour, so to speak, whether it was in your stomach or in the painting. At any rate, Sugiura did remount it, and you see the result at the right, and it's flatter, but also something was necessarily lost in the sharpness of brushwork. So it isn't the same, painting it was before, and I'm sorry for that. We did the best we could. I did what I think was the right thing, but because of the bad work of Kinoshita, it received some damage. In any case, it's a painting that might well have been a real Xia Gui, maybe is a real Xia Gui. The trees at the upper left look that way, the slope, quite a wonderful painting, and this huge rocky mass in the lower left, again, a painting that has no artificiality at all, no obvious plan, complete naturalness, no human signs at all, the water flowing out of the distance over the rocks in a quite wonderful way, and then mists or fogs hiding much of the middle ground and curling around behind the ridge and so forth. Okay, here anyway is a wonderful painting. Old Freer collection, as I say. Freer bought paintings that were cheap at the time. These are things that were not valued in China, and they were sold to the foreigners because they weren't valued. There we are again. Before going on to some more problematic paintings ascribed to Xia Gui, let me insert here a few more that deserve to be taken seriously, I think, when some ambitious person attempts a catalogue raisonné, as it's called, a study list that is of reliable and probable works for Xia Gui. This is an album leaf in the Indianapolis Art Institute that bears Xia Gui's signature, and that matches fairly closely the styles of others we've seen. At worst, it's the work of a close follower. Again, it's an evening scene with a returning fisherman who has moored his boat at the end of the spit of land, and with his pole over his shoulder, he approaches a house under trees. This much is pretty familiar. A flight of birds appears above, and maybe touches of evening red in the sky. It's a lovely leaf, and one that's worth some attention. The next, please. Here's a signed leaf in the Palace Museum, Beijing, with a scholar sitting alone in his house among the bamboo and trees. The signature is very small. The painting is a bit hard, but one can imagine Xia Gui, perhaps at an early stage in his career as an academy master, painting such a picture. There's a lot that looks fresh and right about it. Next, please. This one in the same collection, by contrast, representing two men in a house and a fisherman in a boat in winter, seems less acceptable. The signature is too large and showy. Xia Gui signed his name unobtrusively, if at all. And the brushwork is harsher, more angular. Some of this can be excused by its being a winter scene, but not all. Okay, now I'll go on to see some paintings that maybe are not really by Xia Gui, but worth attention. Here is a painting in a Japanese collection, Shimizu collection, reproduced in the Suiboku book. I have a reference there. Landscape with a man on a path with his servant approaching a thatched building by the water. Ink on silk, hanging scroll, and there is a Xia Gui signature somewhere here. Now, I saw this in the original. I made details that I'll show in a minute. I was inclined to think maybe not quite Xia Gui, but I could be wrong. I mean, I leave this one open. It's a fine painting, and the tree groves are fairly convincing, and the hand of the artist is not too obtrusive, and the slopes are interestingly done. It could be a close follower. It could be Xia Gui at one point in his career. We don't know. Here, the detail of the lower part. Two figures drawn rather more fully and with more sort of narrative, whatever, particularity than you're likely to find in Xia Gui, who simplifies his figures and makes you imagine more and shows less. And similarly for the house and the running of the water. But it's either a rather uncharacteristic Xia Gui at some point in his career, or it's a close imitator. And it's a fine painting in any case, so it deserves its attention. Here another detail still closer up. You see the figure of the man, you see his face and his beard and his sort of crooked staff, and he's bent over, and you see his feet. In other words, much more than Xia Gui is ordinarily going to show. And the servant behind him with his lumpy face, sort of chin hanging down. That's a little more characterizing and specific than Xia Gui is normally going to be. Okay, next please. Oh, this is way down on the scale. This is just a poor imitation. There's a Xia Gui signature over here in the middle left. This is in the Palace Museum, or one of the Palace Museums, not sure which. Doesn't matter a lot anyway. Man in a pavilion. Wind and rain and a tree up above. This is a kind of maybe overly dramatized and overly simplified picture that is painted in the Xia Gui manner. As I say, he doesn't have much really significant following, unfortunately, in China. Yes, he does in the Muromachi Japan more, Sesshu and so on. Now here, and I have a slide made only from a photograph, a landscape in wind and rain. This is in Seren's book, plate 301 in Seren. This is a quite famous painting in Japan, and I did see it once, and I'm still not, again, quite sure. I'm not going to say absolutely not. There's a signature down in the lower left. It could be a quite beautiful imitation, copy, whatever. It's ink on paper in this case, and here's the detail. As you see, in a rather wetter manner, with much more prominence to the brushwork. It's lively. The brushwork is lively in a way that Xia Gui normally isn't. It doesn't have that terseness and quiet of Xia Gui. A man down here in the lower right is arriving under an umbrella and making his way through the wind and rain and about to cross this rickety bridge to arrive at the waterside house here. On the balcony of which the man is standing with his servant behind him. The man is kind of leaning out and turning leftward, turning inward, looking in, and then these quite wonderfully wind-whipped leaves and vines on the tree. The whole effect of wind and rain is quite wonderful. So it's just a fine painting, and then the Xia Gui-like crest up above with a bit of foliage being blown by the wind again. It's quite a wonderful painting, and I'm not absolutely sure one way or the other again. Okay, next please. This conversation on a riverbank, two people seated on a bank here under a pine tree hanging down from a heavily overhanging cliff, ink on silk, album leaf originally folded in the center, further shore with bamboo dimly seen. This is an imitation. It was in the Chinese Art Treasures exhibition. It was not my choice. It shouldn't have been, I think. I'm pretty sure it's signed. Anyway, yes, it is somewhere. But in the Chinese Art Treasures exhibition, as I say, you'll see it there, but not the real Xia Gui. Imitation. Next, please. Okay, now this is something else. This is a fine painting, and I think maybe a close copy of an even finer painting. It's in the Nelson Gallery in Kansas City, and as I've said before, I think on only one occasion, because you don't have occasion to say it much, Larry Sickman very seldom made mistakes. And this is not exactly a mistake. It's just an old painting that may not be the real hand of Xia Gui. I'm a little... it's been published quite a bit. Max Lohr has it. Seren has it. Eight Dynasties catalog, of course, has it. 12 Views from a Thatched Cottage. Supposed to be by Xia Gui. And the four character titles of the different views are written in it. And I'm inclined to think it's, as I say, a close copy. Okay, let me just show it and talk about that. What we have here now on the screen, the section at the left, ferry boat crossing in a misty village. Tsun is just a cluster of houses, or we translate it village, but it means little dwelling, whatever. Anyway, houses among trees on the shore. And here it is up closer. Well, there's something a little too smooth and continuous about the edges of the misty forms. And, I won't say too much here. It'll be more clear maybe as we go on. Then another section of it here, the fisherman's flute, pure solitude, whatever, and a fisherman playing the flute, and other fishermen on the shore, and a lot of space, and ink washes. There must have been a very fine composition behind it, and it's still quite fine in its way. It exists in other versions, by the way. This is the best by far. And then here's a passage of trees, and it's this kind of thing that makes me question it's the real hand of Xia Gui. It isn't quite up to what he does, and the texture, the strokes on the slope of the bluff here, going downward diagonally, are a little too calligraphic, and the tree foliage isn't, for my money, quite the way he wants should do it. Look in the upper right here, and these little strokes that are somehow detached and below the tree foliage. And then, as you come in, here's a passage. Look at the way the roots of the two trees, and then he puts in a little bush down here, of which the foliage somehow covers the space between the two trees above, as though he's sort of correcting something that went wrong. It's very strange, and not, I think, really, not really the hand of Xia Gui. Even the dian, the dots, are somehow a little too detached from the forms. Here, close up again. Yeah. This passage bothers me particularly. I don't think that Xia Gui would have done it this way. Or, as I say, it's as if he's covering up a mistake. You cannot quite read this spatially, why this little bush comes and somehow obscures what seems to be the land mass beyond. Okay, then here at the end, it's quite beautiful, and it's been much admired by many people, and it was bought by Sickman, which means it can't be other than a fine painting. So I have the greatest admiration for him. As I say, he practically didn't make mistakes. Here, anyway, is the gate of a city or a village beyond, and fishermen drawn up and people arriving on the path and so on. Here closer up, the misty mooring and anyway, late night. Okay, good painting, but maybe not quite the real thing. There's one more which shows the. Does this have the signature? It does. Well, okay, it makes my point. The foliage and so on is maybe a bit too detached from the tree limbs. The dots are a little too jittery and detached from the landscape forms, etc. More like the Kotoin painting in that way, paintings. Okay, the next. Now here, this is really wrong Xia Gui. This is a one of two sections I'll show in a handscroll, long handscroll, ink on silk, titled 10,000 Miles on the Yangtze River. This is in the Palace Museum in Taipei now, I think. At any rate, it has impressive seals and colophones, but it's obviously a Ming painting, to me at least, a Ming painting of rather mediocre quality. And unhappily, this was the painting that was sent to represent Xia Gui instead of the real thing in the 1935-36 London exhibition. And as I've said several times, I think the committee that chose the paintings for that deliberately chose paintings that were not the real thing. In the case of a Meyer, and they sent the real one by mistake. I talked about that. But at any rate, I think it set back the study of early Chinese painting in the West in quite considerably. But somebody should write an article about that and either find evidence for why I'm right or wrong. But the painting of the, for instance, look at the bank of the river here with these repeated diagonal brushstrokes. That's a very bad painting. And the whole liveliness of it and too much happening and not Xia Gui at all, the drawing of the water. And here's another section, often reproduced, in which the boat is coming down the rapids in a river, and people in the foreground are driving donkeys, all very lively, much more Ming than Song. People waving their arms like this, we would see if we went ahead in paintings associated with Dai Jin and other Ming artists. So generally, it's a Ming painting, falsely ascribed to Xia Gui. A few more words about that before going on. At left is the cover of the Chinese catalog of this London exhibition. At right, the page in it with the fake Xia Gui on it. I mean to write an article at least for my website about this matter, which seems to me an important event in the history of our field, the one that needs to be clarified. When I've made this argument, I've sometimes been met with a counterargument from people who are disturbed by the implications of mine, so they try to defend the Chinese Selection Committee, saying, but this was still the 1930s, after all, when the study of Chinese painting wasn't yet fully developed. The Chinese Selection Committee didn't deliberately send bad paintings, they just made mistakes. Next, please. So I prepared a counter-argument to refute that one. I point out that when in the following year, 1937, the Chinese government organized a great exhibition of Chinese paintings to be shown in China. The catalog for that is what in my index is called the Nanking Exhibition Catalog. Its cover and title page are now on the screen. Next, please. In that one, they managed to include virtually all the great early paintings in the Palace Museum collection, none of which had gone to London. Here's the real Xia Gui pure and remote view scroll in the Nanking Exhibition Catalog. The selection committee for the London show knew exactly what they were doing. I understand their motives, worries about the safety of these great and irreplaceable paintings, feelings that the foreigners wouldn't fully appreciate them anyway, and I might have done the same thing in their place. But the bad effect that this decision had on Western studies of Chinese painting wasn't alleviated by good intentions behind it. All right. Now I'll go on to an addendum to this lecture on Xia Gui, which will be made up of new materials that I've managed to locate or retrieve since we did the main section, beginning with a few hanging scrolls that can be plausibly ascribed to him and his followers. But first let me say, as I did for Ma Yuan, that Xia Gui is an artist who badly needs a serious dissertation-length study that will address authenticity problems and attempt to construct for him an oeuvre or a body of reliable work. A biography is impossible because writers of his time and shortly afterwards failed to record enough information about him to allow that. A few studies of Xia Gui have been attempted, but none has even begun to fill the need. Next, please. Suzuki K, who's seen here seated to the right with Kohata Hironobu at left. Suzuki K presented a paper on Xia Gui at the Great Symposium in Taiwan in 1970, in which he ended up accepting no paintings at all, which genuinely from Xia Gui's hand. I've spoken about that already. I myself wrote a longish entry on Xia Gui for the Encyclopedia Britannica, the 1947 edition, which you will find there if you want to read it. But limits of space and the number of illustrations kept it from being anything like what we need. And I devoted 7.5 pages to him in my index of early Chinese painters and paintings. Next, please. One of the best students in my early period at Berkeley, and one of the original eight that produced the Restless Landscape exhibition and catalog, it was she, in fact, who came up with that title, Elizabeth Fulder, took on Xia Gui as a dissertation topic, but after working on it for several years, she decided to end her academic career and marry Mark Wilson, who was himself working on a dissertation on Ma Yuan. I couldn't attend their wedding, but I sent a telegram beginning, quote, Ma is wed at last to Xia. Stop. Greetings from your absent Pa. Stop. And continuing in a way I won't quote. So neither of them finished their dissertations. He became the director of the Nelson Gallery, following Larry Sickman. She founded the highly successful firm Asiatica, which makes elegant women's wear from old fabrics that she finds in Japan. She had begun as a design major. And the age of doing one artist dissertations, especially for Southern Song artists, is pretty much over anyway. Okay, now on to some more paintings by and ascribed to Xia Gui. Beginning with, next please, this large hanging scroll in the old Freer collection. A large painting representing one of the eight views of the Shaoxiang region, Autumn Moon on Lake Dongting. Freer acquired it in 1919 from a Shanghai collector dealer. We rediscovered it while I was still at the Freer as a curator, and I think I had it remounted. My memory is unclear. But I left the Freer staff without really writing it up or publishing it. It's no less than 190 centimeters in height, almost 2 meters, and 109 centimeters wide, over a meter. And it bears Xia Gui's signature, taking the form Chun Xia Gui Zhur, or Your Subject Xia Gui Made This, written on the leftmost tree, not visible in these images. The poem, which as I say is one of the eight views of the Shaoxiang series, I'll speak of them more in the last lecture, is inscribed in large characters at the top by some unidentified imperial hand. This was presumably one of the eight large hanging scrolls painted by Xia Gui as a court artist, and one that happens to survive. It bears collector seals of Xiang Yuan Bian and others. The poem written at the top reads, as translated in the Freer website, Autumn Moon on Lake Dongting. Oranges fragrant from every shore, green and yellow, emerge. I moor my boat at dusk, besides a shack of sticks and thorns. Mid surging waves, the lovely moon is like a winsome maid who playfully seems to vaunt, I think they mean to flaunt, her graceful feminine charms. In the deep of night, when no clouds obscure the Milky Way, lofty winds then skim the surface, ruffling its whiteness. 5 o'clock, and somewhere far off a painted horn is blowing. When I am dressed and go to work, the golden bowl has sunk. I suppose that last line means that the moon is set. Anyway, the painting seems entirely believable as a major surviving work by Xia Gui. The trees are his, and the huge rocky mass jutting out from the shore. It's on very dark silk, so it's hard to see. The Mounter Sugiyoto once showed me how he could, if we wanted, lighten the silk of an old painting chemically, but that has some dangers too. Anyway, all right, next please. Another surviving hanging scroll by Xia Gui that's probably genuine, but that I can only call to your attention with this old slide made from a reproduction, I have no images from the original, is this landscape with drying nets in the old collection of the Boston Museum of Fine Arts. They acquired it in 1914. I note in my index that it is much retouched and exists also in other versions, but my distant memory is of finding it in fine and convincing work when I saw it in the original years ago. Next, please. This one in the Metropolitan Museum of Art is a large album leaf, about 25 centimeters in height by 21 centimeters in width. It was acquired for the Met from John Ferguson in 1914. It bears a Xia Gui signature on the middle right edge. My memory is of doubting it in old days, but Wenfeng in his Beyond Representations book, page 177, takes it to be a genuine work and reads it as a representation of Mountain Market in Clearing Mist, another of the eight views of the Shaoxing region. Although I don't think he's right about the subject, he may be right about the authenticity of the painting. It has a lot to recommend it as a real Xia Gui, featuring an original composition in strongly rendered forms. The subject is really of the type, I think, of which we saw several examples in our lecture on followers of Li Tang, in which the road enters in the lower left corner over a bridge on which we see two travelers, or a traveler and a servant, making their way toward the village or resting place on the rocky knoll among groves of leafy trees. That's the central focus of the composition. The road continues, and the continuation of their journey after their rest or overnight stop in the lower right, going around a bluff and disappearing above to the right. So in that respect, the composition is familiar and conventional. But Xia Gui, if it is indeed he, reinvents it, makes it fresh with his own distinctive forms. The tree groves have the right depth and naturalness. The rocks have the striking volumetric treatment that we expect of Xia Gui's rocky masses. All in all, I'm inclined to revise my old judgment and include this among the works to be taken seriously as really from the hand of the master. Next, please. Here is a pair of hanging scrolls from the Japanese catalog of Southern Sung painting, then in some Japanese collection. More recently, if my memory is right, they have gone through auction. They bear an absurd attribution to Mio Run, of all people, an artist who couldn't have painted this way if he wanted to, which he didn't. The attribution reflects only the practice of attaching the names of famous literati artists, such as Li Gonglin and Mio Run, to old and fine paintings that are really quite beyond their powers. These two paintings appear to me, from the reproductions, to be the work of some follower of Xia Gui. They resemble in some features the Kotoin landscapes, wrongly ascribed to Li Tang, which we have seen already in this lecture. Fine, spacious paintings as they are, note the skillful depiction of the path that winds through the trees in the one at left, ending at the water's edge. They raise once more the question of Xia Gui's following and why it's so hard to identify, a problem I'll return to later. To the purchaser of these, if she or he sees this lecture, I say, if you bought them as Mio Run paintings, you got better than you deserve. If you bought them as fine late Sung works in the Xia Gui manner, congratulations, you have a good eye. Next, please. Now on to album leaves ascribed to Xia Gui, beginning with these two fan paintings, both in the Metropolitan Museum of Art, both published in Wenfeng's book, from which I took these images. Neither of them is presented there, by the way, as a genuine Xia Gui. The one at left presents thatched houses and bamboo beneath leafy trees on the shore. In the one at right, the traveler by river or canal has alighted on the shore and walks on, leaving the boatman and his boy helper in the boat. Both seem to me to fall into the category of what I would call almost Xia Gui's. I won't go on to point out the features of style that keep them from being real Xia Gui's, because sharp-eyed viewers, the ones I'm principally addressing in these lectures, can spot them by now. But it's worth noting how many Xia Gui and would-be Xia Gui paintings are in old American collections. The early collectors were influenced, as indeed they should have been, by the Japanese passion for Ma Yuan and Xia Gui, which they knew of partly from Fenelosa's book, where they appear as Ba En and Ka Ke, and partly from the dealers and Asian collectors that they dealt with. And they were eagerly seeking out their works. It was only later that more advanced scholarship, as it considered itself to be, scoffed at this passion for the Ma Xia style and worked to turn collectors' attention to acquisitions of works by more prestigious masters. Next, please. Another fan-shaped leaf, which I show in two images, both made from reproductions, is this signed Xia Gui fan painting in the Palace Museum in Beijing, number 47 of the big volume of 100 Song album leaves. This one, by contrast, seems to me probably the real thing. I'm deliberately alternating good and bad to keep your eyes tuned. A road comes around the bluff in lower left, where the signature is, small and convincing, to continue over a simple bridge and then disappear behind large rocks from which leafy trees grow. The road emerges at the right of these, and on it a solitary figure, a man bent with age and fatigue, walking with a staff, approaching his longed-for destination, houses on the shore. Another moving image of lateness and return. Note the richly varied foliage of the trees and the way the groups of them are given depth by varying ink tone. Note also the glimpse we are given by the artist of a further bank in lower right and a stream that flows into the larger watercourse. This is a sensitive, space-creating Xia Gui touch. The seals of the best collectors confirm our judgment. I wish I had good original slides and details of this one. Okay, next please. For a change of subject, but still a painting with an attribution to Xia Gui, here's a picture of a gibbon hanging from a tree branch that projects out over the water. I believe I saw and photographed it in the collection of Cheng Chi. It was acquired by the Cleveland Museum of Art, and it's in the Eight Dynasties catalog as number 59, with an entry written by Howard Rogers, who, understandably enough, would like to accept the attribution. I used to complain that too much of the writing in our field was done for exhibition and collection catalogs, for which the authors are inclined to give the paintings the benefit of the doubt, which what we need, I argued, was more independent judgment by people with no interest in the paintings beyond the scholarly. It's entirely possible, of course, that Xia Gui would have painted such a picture outside his ordinary range of subjects. Next, please. But the signature at right, seen in this detail, doesn't appear to read Xia Gui, but rather Xia Lin, the latter written with two trees. Xia Gui is recorded as having had a painter's son named Xia Shan, written with three trees, and one theory is that this was another son. The painting of the cliff seen in this detail doesn't look like it came from the hand of Xia Gui, rather from some lesser academician. Next. The gibbon also looks like the work of a good but not extraordinary master. One would like to think that Xia Gui, if he had decided to paint a gibbon, would have given us a more distinctive one. The long arms are stiff, the face doesn't hold our attention as it should. Next, please. Two fan-shaped album leaves, finally, with attributions to Xia Gui, the one it left in the Palace Museum, Beijing, and published as number 50 in the Big Book of Song album leaves, the one at right taken from the catalog of the Southern Song Exhibition in Japan, number 29 in that, a painting in the Tokyo National Museum. The one at left looks like a copy or the work of a more heavy-handed follower. It portrays a scene with a simple shelter, like a small thatched hut, near the river shore. The recluse who lives in it has come out to sit on the bank and play his chin, or zither. We imagine the merging of the quiet music and the sound of the water calming his mind. The one at right has a better chance of being from the hand of the master, I think, or at least of some early and sensitive artist. A herd boy astride a buffalo is urging the beast into the water, while at the right a calf hurries to join them. The marshy ground with low vegetation and faint indications of paths running through it, the nearer and further hilltops, the faint clouds in what I take to be an evening sky, all these are sensitively conceived and rendered, and raise this leaf to the level of Xia Gui's work, whether or not it's by him. The two paintings raise again the question of Xia Gui's following, why it's so sparse, so lacking in identifiable works by recognized masters. Part of the reason lies in the bad reception that Xia Gui received shortly after his own time. The literati critic Zhuang Su, writing in 1298 in his Huaji Bui, has this to say about Xia Gui, as translated by Howard Rogers, quote, "He painted landscapes and figures that were extremely vulgar and loathsome. At the end of the Song, social morality withered and died. The hearts of people withered and shifted. Xia Gui thus excessively achieved fame at that time. In reality, his art had nothing to recommend it, and it's enough to know his period of activity and name and nothing more." End quote. The reaction of early Yuan writers close to Zhao Mengfu, and Zhuang Su was one of them, can partly be understood as political. They associated the late Ming Academy and its styles with the age of Chinese weakness that had permitted the Mongol conquest. Their scoffing name for Ma Yuan, One Corner Ma, was partly an allusion to his compositions, but it also reflected this political charge. But Zhuang Su's was also the kind of reaction that a New York critic devoted to abstract expressionism might have had to an artist who went on painting pictures, and gloriously painterly pictures. He would insist loudly, "Don't look at the picture, look at the brushstrokes. Aug." Next. The lineage of style running from Li Tong through Ma Yuan is continued in the Yuan by a few artists such as Sun Junsu, now scarcely recognized in China, and by some artists of the Zhou school in the Ming, such as Dai Jin. A following for Xia Gui, by contrast, is difficult to identify, and we're almost forced to conclude that this incomparably great development of ink monochrome landscape painting that comes to a climax in his works, a very quiet climax, one has to add, in such paintings as the Hikgoan Leaf, a more spectacular climax in the Pure and Remote View Scroll, after which the series was named, that this development was not to be significantly continued in China. This was a huge loss, partly offset, to be sure, by the greatness of some Yuan painting, but still a huge loss. Think back for a moment about what underlay it, what Xia Gui had inherited next. The great development of a monumental landscape type in the early Northern Song that sacrificed color and variety for a monochrome style that allowed the grand attainment of unity and integrity. Next, the further development of that style in the hands of Guo Xi and others into a pictorial medium that could achieve effects of space and light that are virtually unparalleled elsewhere in art. Next, please. Effects that are then sacrificed in the pursuit of a different vision, one that renders landscapes as perceptual experience in the way supremely exemplified by this dream journey on the Xiaoshang scroll by Master Li and Anhui, a work we should remember that the literati critics and the collectors they dominated would not have transmitted to us if it hadn't been falsified into a work by one of their number, Li Gonglin. Next, please. Or by the Westlake scroll, loosely ascribed to the earlier Academy Master Li Song, another work that captures an experience of visual perception in a way hard to match in world art, at least before the 19th century. Xia Gui inherited all that and would have, if the tradition had been allowed to continue, passed it on brilliantly in a new form to his followers. But that kind of tradition was not allowed to continue. It gave way to a new aesthetic and a new set of critical dogmas, scornful of the old style traditions in art, intent instead on celebrating the artist who broke the rules. So, once again, does this sound all too familiar? Next, we haven't yet quite reached the end of the development of ink monochrome landscape in the Song. In our last lecture on Chan Buddhist painting, we'll still see some exciting works by Chan masters working at the end of Song, artists whose paintings have accordingly not been transmitted in China, but have been preserved almost entirely in Japan. But that development, too, was virtually without follow-up in China. Next. It's true that a few professional artists of the later centuries were capable of painting ink monochrome landscapes that preserved strong elements of the Southern Song tradition. But when they did, as in this landscape by the early 15th century master Dai Jin in the Shanghai Museum, they were likely to invoked the kind of reaction expressed in the inscription written at the top by the late Ming critic and theorist Dong Qichang, beginning, quote, "The professional artists earlier in the Ming all took Dai Wenjin to be a great master," end quote, meaning or implying we of the cognoscenti know better. Next, the Japanese master Sesshu, who spent 2 years studying in China from 1467 and mastered the late Song Academy styles to a high level, could imitate Ma Yuan and Xia Gui and the splashed ink landscapes of the Chan masters quite capably. Next. But he went on to turn this into a specifically Japanese style, in a way I'll try to outline in a lecture in a follow-up series on Sesshu. So the ink monochrome landscape manner that reached such a high point in the works of Xia Gui was not to have any significant continuation in China during the centuries that followed. I'll talk more about that matter, which is of deep concern to me, in an aftermath to the final lecture in our series. This one on Xia Gui ends here.